We're inside the main temple of Dendera in Egypt. And you can't get a sense of the scale, I don't think, with photographs and even with this video. But hopefully this will give you an idea. This was a temple from the Old Kingdom of Egypt dedicated to Hathor, who is represented as obviously a female and with cow's ears. Made out of solid sandstone, but each one of these columns is multiple sections. You can see the lines running this way as we go along. You can see how each column is a stack. Now the reason why the faces are not in great shape is that they were destroyed by later people, possibly the Romans, in order to try to kill the spirit of Hathor. And I can't think of anything in the modern age which can rival just the grandeur of this place. It's mind-boggling. Solid stone building that's been here from the Old Kingdom. So you're talking at least 4,000 years. We're with Stephen Mailer, and he's going to explain where we are and what we're looking at.
We are at the Temple of Hathor in Dendera. Said to be a what they call a Ptolemaic site, 300 BC, but actually on a much, much older area that covers all areas, a very ancient site. Who Hathor was, Hat means place, Hor is usually considered the falcon or the boy or the initiate, so it's the place of the boy. This is where sacred initiations were taking place, but only by priestesses, because this was a matriarchal culture. So Hathor represents all the arts, dancing, music, sculpture, and sexuality. And she's also considered a divine mother, as many of the so-called feminine aspects were. So this was a very, very sacred temple, only populated by women. There were no priests of Hathor, only priestesses. Very sacred information was taught here. The walls have information about astrology, astronomy, and alchemy. And very much a very, very sacred site to the ancient people. We feel, unfortunately, cannot feel this on this video, but people come and feel the soft, sweet, feminine energy here. As my teacher Abdel Hakim said, the site dictates what's there. So the energy here, known to the ancient people, the sweetness, the softness, the wonderful warmth of the feminine, obviously extenuated in them the aspect of Hathor, so they built temples around to venerate the principle. And what we teach is these were not gods and goddesses. It's called, the word is Netter. And Netter is translated an aspect of the whole, a principle, or a sense, that we actually have these senses within us. So we come to these sites to activate these energies within us, the feminine, the soft feminine, the music, the dance, the arts. And it raises that consciousness in people. And that was part of the initiation, why people were brought here, to experience the principle, the Netter, and activate it within themselves. This is a wonderful, wonderful site. We wish everyone in the world could come and experience the divine feminine energy that is here.
It's being shown. You can touch it, but here, the giants here are the ancient Cremations. They're being picked as giants. Now, we say to people, is it symbolic or is it actual? Why does it have to be either or? Why can it not be both? They could have been giants, but giants of mind.
Uh-huh.
Okay, depicted. Showing here what obviously Chris first pointed this out in 1998 in the Giza power plant. This is a Crookes tube, obviously. Again, some people will say, and I won't mention names, that this is just symbolic. Why does it have to be both? This shows a knowledge of electricity that was there. Why, if it's symbolic, do you have a wire being plugged into a box?
I thought that was...
Of course. Yeah. And this is the backbone of Osiris.
Ah.
The Jed pillar. Where they come to the name, used in Arabic today in Egypt, Jeddah means grandpa. Papa, Hakim was always called Jeddah. Mm. Jeddah. Jed pillar. But what it is, the backbone of Osiris, Opus, represents the spinal column. Electricity being produced. This is producing electricity, clearly.
So if we see that elsewhere, that's the backbone.
That's the Jed pillar. I'll point it out, Jed pillar.
Yes.
Now, to finish it, you have to go against the wall to see the final scene.
Wait, sorry.
Go ahead. You'll get time to take the picture.
Oh, yes, I will.
Okay, yes. As soon as we're done.
Sorry, I don't want to.
Next scene.
We just want to finish the story.
Yeah.
Again, giant commissions. The same thing. But here, the beam, and again, the snake is always kundalini energy, always electricity. The beam is being deflected. Why is it being, he's holding up these knives. This creature, argument, it's always an argument what this creature is. Hakim said this is the baboon, the companion of Jehoti, Toth, and it's a symbol of wisdom. But Hike Wesselman, who came with me, who was an anthropologist, said, no, that baboons don't have tails like this. He thought it was a reptile. Whatever it is, whatever you want to think. But it is a creature, and Hakim would say, it is the texts that tell us what's happening here. The texts say that this is a knowledge of credible energy and wisdom that can be abused. This is the origin of the myth of Atlantis right here, folks, from the old kingdom of Egypt, saying that the ancient people had a great knowledge, a great technology that could be abused in modern times. This is a warning to the dynastic people from the ancient commissions, but first written in the modern script, that great knowledge was known, a great wisdom can be abused. That's the warning. And here he's showing the knowledge of, he's got it under that's control it. With both oh. hands. Snake staff, they had the knowledge of electricity, clearly. Anybody can argue symbolic all they want. This shows they had an actual practical knowledge of electricity.
So with the two knives that are being held, could it be symbolic of one can cut and make you bleed and the other can cut and be of use? So either it's of use or it's of abuse.
Very good, because Hakim would totally agree with that. Everything's in polarities, everything's in duality, and he's using both hands.
Right.
Exactly. But the text warns against the abuse of this knowledge.
Wow.
Here we have the famous Zodiac of Dendara. This is a copy. The original was taken by the French during Napoleon's expedition in 1798 and is in the basement of the Louvre. One of the things that we agreed with Sahi was for many years, he wanted the original Zodiac to return to Egypt, the Rosetta Stone, which is in the British Museum, and the Bust of Nefertiti, which is in the Berlin Museum. They belong here. We agree with that. What it clearly shows, this copy is still an excellent copy, all signs of the Zodiac, Leo, Taurus, Sagittarius over here, all around you see all the signs of the Zodiac. The total knowledge of astrology, which the Greeks refined, did not invent, but they refined. But there is a secret meaning here, which very few people understand. Cancer, right here in the center, plays a key significant role. The great French Alsatian mathematician, philosopher R.A. Schwaller de Lubitsch, who John Anthony West is the champion of today, did some incredible calculations showing, because he was a mathematician, showing that there's different angles, everything is leading to cancer, to everyone to look at cancer here. So what do we know? Based on my research, the research of Barbara Hanclow and others, there's no evidence that human beings practice astrology or astronomy before 8,000 BCE. 8,000 BCE is the age of cancer. The Zodiac is telling us when astrology began.
And that also tells us that before that there was a global cataclysm.
But yes, exactly. And it's also indicating that there was no age of Leo, age of, it starts with Cancer. They surmised that it went back during the whole procession that there was an age. So this is why, for those who argue that the Sphinx represents the astrological signs of Leo and Virgo, impossible. For when the Sphinx was created, there was no astrology.
Because that's when the ancient people say the sky fell.
Exactly.
And so the axis of the earth may have been different at
exactly.
this time.
Exactly. And so the people started observing at 8,000 BCE, created the zodiac, created the constellations, and created the idea that we needed to predict because an invader had come from the sky. Something had damaged the earth, and so they needed to go to solstices, equinoxes, eclipses, study all of these things so they could perhaps predict when another invader became obsessed with time and prediction. Did not exist in ancient Kemet at all.
And so the obsession with the sky then becomes a result of the fear of a return of the great cataclysm.
As people have been saying on this tour, PSD, incredible PSD. Those that survived the cataclysm were obsessed with trying to know if it was going to happen again. And they had this collective fear that pervaded all that they did. So yes, when the sky fell.
So in the main temple in Abydos, in Egypt, this is where the glyphs are that look like 20th century technology. what you have are what people think of as modern machines. That one, some say, looks like a tank.
And a yacht.
That one, some people say, looks just like a Bell Jet Ranger helicopter. And this is the one. People say it looks like a plane.
This one, absolutely.
So this is the backside of the temple of Osiris at Abydos. And it doesn't look like much because the beautiful work is inside the building. You go down that set of stairs, a long set of stairs, and then you enter where there are huge round columns. It's a massive internal complex. But what's intriguing and stupefies a lot of people is that below the surface is where you find the megalithic. This is the Osirion. And you can see there's water in it. The water is coming up from the ground. And the question is, how much older is this than that? Because this was buried under the sand. Whenever you're ready, Dr. Mailer.
Well, this is the Osirion at Abydos. It is behind the known temple, which they call the Temple of Seti. It was the Temple of Osiris. And amazingly, they date this temple, at the same time period as the temple in front, which is impossible. This is huge blocks of granite. It's the only granite temple in the south. Our teacher, Abdel Hakim, dated this at 50,000 years, at the same age of the Valley Temple. There's no inscriptions inside the temple. The only inscriptions on top appear much, much older, clearly not from the same time period. Again, you can never date a temple from what the inscriptions are. But there's no inscriptions inside. And this is huge blocks of granite, weighing 100 tons at least.
At least.
At least.
And how far are we from the actual quarry?
The quarry is Aswan, mm-hmm. So less than 100 miles.
But still, 100 miles.
Yes.
And these blocks weigh...
North. We're further than Luxor.
Luxor is 200 kilometers. It's probably 200 miles.
Oh, 200 miles.
200 miles, because he's, as Yusuf just said, we're north of Luxor.
Exactly.
I was contemplating from Luxor.
Okay, but some of these blocks are 100 tons is a good estimate of the size.
Yes, 200 tons, Papa would say. 200 tons here. Look at this major block right over here.
Yeah.
Looks like part of the ceiling.
Aywa, part of the ceiling, right there, the ceiling of the temple.
And was
writings it? The on the other side over there was made by the grandson of Seti.
Ah, okay.
That's right.
Was it at one time buried completely?
Yeah. Before the high dam.
Oh,
the high dam is what's ruined this. Uh-huh. Before the high dam, you could go down into the rooms, and Yusuf and Patricia have posted pictures on the Kemet site that they have been down in there when the water's down. Mm-hmm. It's an incredible experience to go in these chambers. I've been waiting for years. I'll keep coming back.
At least 12.
All right, we'll go with 12. That's a conservative number.
That one there.
So if we say 8 times 8 times 12, multiply that by 175, so 175 pounds per cubic feet, you have 134,000 pounds, which is... 67 tons.
67?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's 67 tons.
Yeah.
This vertical one, conservatively
I think it's
measured.
That is conservative.
You have to be
200 miles from
exactly,
the quarry.
Your work.
Otherwise you get trashed.
That's right.
Have
I
you
say 100 tons.
Have you had a chance, Chris, to measure the vertical in terms of how close it is to being...
We never got down in there.
Oh, you've never been
that's
in?
That's why I can't speak to the precision.
Okay. This is Karnak Temple, and the very famous, this is the entrance point, and the very famous row of rams on either side. that guide you in. This is most likely the original entrance, but it's been built on many times by many cultures. So it's not just one giant complex built by the quote-unquote Egyptians, but over thousands of years, and the way you can tell is by looking at the different construction styles. Now, automatically, what's curious to me is if you see those notches, those rectangular notches, over here on this wall, you'll see here you see two rows up there, and here you see areas where there's only one row, and they don't match bilaterally. So that could mean later repair, one side compared to the other. What you also notice is as you see this building style and then this building style. You see no mortar, and then it seems that you do see mortar. So this is probably the original. It's quite common at entrance points that an original gate is the original and that everything is built around it. But we'll look more and more for stuff like this. And again, having just walked through the entryway, limestone everywhere, but right in the path is quartzite, this giant block. Hewn with quite good accuracy, it looks like, if you look at the profile here. So this to me looks like part of the original temple. Again, we're looking for the harder stones because they're actually the oldest. The softer stones, like limestone, would have been later when the knowledge of the ancient technology was lost. And they had to use, for the limestone, bronze chisels and stone hammers. Here we have our first possible example of lost ancient technology. This hole. I think I can see a spiral groove as in a drill bit inside, but you need to actually be able to get an impression with some kind of latex, some kind of other material to find out. But at least using these calipers, and this is an approximation, I am not an engineer, but an approximation 70 millimeters across, and we take it out and we move it around, and again it doesn't want to move, so it's around 70 millimeters, and then this way 90 degrees from there, and again it's around approximately the same. The gauge doesn't want to move that much, so clearly it's, you can define this as being a round hole. Can't prove that it's done by a drill bit, would have to be here more than the 10 minutes we have. But this could very well be an example of where this stone had a pragmatic function, the hole had a pragmatic function. After this original civilization disappeared, the stone itself was recycled. The hole had to be simply incorporated into the next function, which may have been ceremonial. The hole wouldn't have been used, but it's still there as a testament to the fact that lost ancient technology could very well have been at work here. So this is an obelisk, and I'll do a close-up later, but what's more intriguing is Jerry, who was on our tour, found a really obvious example of a core drill in this chunk of granite. That's the approximate width. Trouble is it's recessed, so we can't get a good measure of it, but you can see inside there. You know, you can see that it's relatively round. You can see where the core, it's like a tube drill. There's a centerpiece that came out, that was popped out. And if you look deeply into here, you can see the wall or thickness of the core drill was very small. And then here, you see where the core drill actually changed angle or slipped. So that's a really obvious example of most likely ancient core drilling technology. Because why else would it be here? Why would someone in modern times have come and decided to pop a sample out? But it's not through one sample that you can make a big difference. You have to find many of them. Now this is really amazing. Mark on our tour found this. This is black granite, super hard material, which just seems to be decomposing from the inside.
What we believe happened here is intense bursts of concentrated bursts of microwave or sonic waves,
right,
altering the physics of the stone. This is black granite that you can crumble in your hands.
Which you should not be able to
do. And yet we're collecting the samples. We're going to send it to an outstanding chemist, Dr. George C. Baer, who will analyze this and tell us how this happened.
Now that's
not natural.
No, this is a great example. A great example. So you see, samples will be sent to a laboratory in order to see what's gone on. And you can see how the surface is cracked, too. Granite doesn't have a tendency, I don't think, to crack, have deep cracks like this just from weathering or sun. But you can see how, look at the difference between the exterior and the interior. It seems like there was something that happened at the core of this stone that destabilized it, and now it's a complete pile of tiny, tiny little bits. Whereas once, it was quite a large, massive column. Amazing. So here we have another example. This is red granite, but you see the break is probably done maybe during Roman times in order to get a useful piece off of it there. But the way the surface of the granite has destabilized, where it's literally sloughing off like this, is not, as far as I have been told, common to granite. Granite doesn't crumble in this way. It's not the result of heat, of the sun beating on it. It's like some kind of energy was inside of it that destabilized it and is causing it now to for the stone to just slough away. Now, to add to the idea that that rose granite could have been used in some kind of sonic or energy technology, this obelisk section, if you strike it with your fist, it makes a sound. Could you please, could you do that a few times, please? You hear that? So that's why people discuss in the esoteric tradition, as well as in science, the fact that stone that had a vibratory quality, as in this rose granite or basalt or alabaster, was used by the ancient ones, in this case the pre-pharaonic people, to make structures because they wanted the vibration. And possibly they wanted the vibration because what they were building were not simply temples. They were building functional energy machines. This is the rose granite quarry at Aswan in Egypt. And this is where we will see the unfinished obelisk. In fact, two. The main unfinished obelisk, which is quite famous, is estimated at 1,200 tons in weight. So we're going to have a look at that. We're also going to look at different ways that the granite was cut. And again here, the normal way. Again, you can see where the wedges were, how the stone has been broken off into, probably in attempted cubes, but in large block form. But underneath it is the older, what would one call it, but scooping kind of technology at work. And here, we see this in the oldest structures in Peru, the pre-Inca works. And this is a classic example of it. Again, this was not done with a bunch of guys with stone pounders. This was done with a technology that, as far as I know, conventional Egyptologists can't explain, as well as pits in the ground like this. And over here. And also see the way that the stone is blistered. It's possible that some kind of heat was applied, or at least some way of destabilizing the stone in order to extract it. And this is a classic example here again.
Okay. The cracks on the earth, on the surface of modern earthquakes, they've been recorded. Uh-huh. The crack that stopped them is on the underside. We went down there in 2004. To his credit, David Hatchett Childress found it. There's a crack on the underside. As Yusuf mentioned, they would then know that it would not go to resonance anymore, so no longer functional as an obelisk, so they stopped work. But Chris and I both believe they still would have used the stone and quarried it. What stopped it is the cataclysm. This is evidence of the cataclysm. That's why they stopped this work. So this piece is at least 12,000 years. So when you go down there, you can look at the scoop marks, make your own determinations how you think that possibly could have done with dolerite pounders or dolerite hammers, and you'll see the crack on the underneath, and you'll realize yourself, and you can go do your own.
Okay.
Good.
So we get an unprecedented experience. 2 minutes. This is the unfinished obelisk. We get to actually go in and have a close look at the marks. Oh, it's good. Thank you. 1,200 tons. It's not only its size and its scale, but how the hell did they shape it? See how narrow the area is in here. So here, now you get a sense of scale. And it's around the side.
This way?
And now we get to actually go down into the pit. So this is the pit. This is the side of the obelisk. This is the wall. This is the way that it was shaped. Now if you have a dolerite pounder, or if you have a stone ball and you're this far away from it, I'm this far away, how can you possibly shape something this hard without having the ability to have the force to strike at it? You don't. So that blows. It doesn't matter how many, again, it's like in Peru, it doesn't matter how many people you have working at it. It's just silly to think that it was done by hand. All these scoops that we see are completely different than the conventional way of cutting and shaping granite in ancient times. And so it looks very much like there was some kind of scooping machine or mechanism that was able to cut out what this is. And this is thank you. This is an unprecedented opportunity to look at one of the greatest achievements in situ. Inside, we have the pit, one of the pits, and these are dolerite pounders. These are hard stone balls that would have been theoretically used to shape it. But the material is too hard for that to be an explanation. Again, very similar to what we see in Peru. Evidence of ancient machining technology. And it's very fortunate that it's unfinished, because it allows us to see the process in action. Okay? So here you get to see up close, or at least from above, the scale of the unfinished obelisk. 1,200 tons. You see the marks on the surface? Those are not the marks of somebody with stone hammers pounding away. These marks inside the groove, the channel on that side, those are not the marks of stone hammers. Those are the marks of ancient technology, because here, there we see, you see those tooth-like things, projections. Again, that's where wedges would have been put in conventional stone, hand stone extraction. But that is completely different from that. This is one of our prime examples of lost ancient technology. With the unfinished obelisk here, what's very, very intriguing is that you see the natural shape of the stone here in the quarry, the roundedness of it, and then swinging past the unfinished obelisk to this wall, which is mind-boggling. That is somewhat like what we see in Peru. But for someone to tell me that that was a bunch of slaves doing this kind of work by hand, you know, talk to an engineer, talk to a stonemason. They'll laugh at you if you say that this was done by hand by a bunch of slaves. This is very much a candidate for lost ancient technology. The crispness of the cutting, the flatness of it. One doesn't leave a surface like that in a quarry in general, as far as I know. Absolutely incredible. And to show this is even more of a joke, this is a dolerite pounder. This is what many scholars believe is the technique used to extract the stone. This is the dolerite. This is the granite. Here we have...
knowledge of electricity.
Yeah. Here we have what looks very much like what we saw in Dendera.
In the crypts.
In the crypts, these so-called light bulbs. And here we have a depiction of something incredibly similar to that. The ones in Dendera are at an angle. These are vertical.
Again,
the snake on the inside.
You're always representing Kundalini or electrical energy.
Yeah, Kundalini energy on the inside. So here's another good example of where it's this temple here. You can see granite, at least this part of it, is listed as being of the Ptolemaic period. Why? Because Alexander the Great's name is carved into the surface of the stone. And Yusuf will show us where we can find Alexander the Great's name.
Right here. These glyphs here are alphabet. It's not like the symbols we saw in the old kingdom time. So we have the letter A, L, K, S, N, D, R, E, S. Alexandris.
Ah, great.
And that's how they did the site to the Ptolemy period. But then when we see the devices inside, we're going to realize that it's pre-dynastic because the machining and because that it has no writings at all.
Uh-huh.
And if you ask the Egyptologist why this device doesn't have writing, he can tell you it wasn't completed.
But exactly.
When you see it, you know that it was completed. All this part was quarried. There was several shrines as the one we see here. Go ahead.
So that gives you a prime example of where, just because it has writing on it, yes, that dates the writing, but it doesn't necessarily date the stone that it's written on. When you go from one culture to another culture, whoa, one time period, another time period, the succeeding culture inherits or steals the artifacts of the earlier culture. So if they do have a writing system, then the writing is put on top of something older. So the oldest things in Egypt do not have writing. Does that mean that they were unsophisticated? No. It means that they didn't need a recorded writing system. It was oral tradition. They used their brains a lot more than we do, because everything had to be recorded in the head. A lot of it was sacred information. You don't write that down, somebody could read it. So that was the job of the masters of any of the professions. They had to keep all of the library in the brain. And this is the great example, or one of the great examples, of something which is so ancient that the sign back there that says Ptolemaic is ridiculous. The Ptolemaic period did work, but it doesn't mean that they did this.
Thank you.
One solid block. And reasonably flat, not perfectly flat, but also take into account that if this is so old, that the surface is worn, but I think it's a pretty flat surface. So here we are in what was turned into a quarry of ancient masterpiece work. And we're going to walk over and have Yusuf Awiyan introduce us to this incredible block.
This was another shrine like the rose granite,
uh-huh,
made from black granite. And what used to happen is that in the different periods of time, that people used to come here, even during the dynasties, to cut from these stones to make their own temples, which proves that they didn't have the ability to do the machining, because taking a clear cut like this, so all he has to do is just take the edge of it and add it as another block in his own temple. And that's how they used to add the writings first. If we come closer, we can see down here that there is a part of a depiction that they were about to add, and they made it with red paint, showing Khnum and showing the probably this is Tutmosis, or it can be Alexander, because they all came above each other. So that's how they used to do it. You see here the figures here made in the red paint.
Uh-huh.
So they used to do the paint and then cut the slab and then carve this and put it as one part of the depictions on the walls. I believe what happened here is that when they were trying to quarry it, it cracked. So when it break apart like this, because they could not cut it in a good way,
uh-huh,
that's why it's left like that. And the other markings there, on that one, that circle over there,
uh-huh,
it's not a base of a pillar, but this is how they used to mark to cut the millstone,
right,
out of the granite.
Uh-huh.
So this granite we see here is what's left after quarrying the site. You can imagine the amount of rose and black granite and milky quartz. Part of the devices, part of the stones we find.
See how
here
flat that is?
It's milky quartz. So there could
this
be
isn't a precision ruler, but it's a ruler for God's sake. It's a steel one. And it's probably an instrument, even though it cost me $3. It's more precise than what the ancient Egyptians probably had, because from what I've seen, the instruments in their tool cabinet found in the archaeological record are wooden. You can't get wood as precise as you can steel. And in the case of an engineer like Christopher Dunn, he has super precision instruments used to test the tolerances of the parts of, for example, jet engines.
But 1968, Marshall McLuhan came here, Canadian, wrote the book The Medium is the Message. He looked at this pyramid and says it produces two frequencies of sound. And he was the first one to come into the ancient understanding. The title of this site supposedly was a king's title, Seneferu. The Egyptologists say that means he of beauty. No, we say it means double harmony. It was not a person's name or even a title. It could be a title to the site. It could be just this pyramid, which produces two frequencies of sound, or this pyramid and the so-called red pyramid, which we'll see later, that produce another frequency of sound. That this was an active living site. Where you're actually filming now, you can see sand dunes. There's silt in there. We have collected soil samples. There's still silt in there from ancient. Does a zero rainfall here per year. So it's natural rainfall. It has to be from the ancient river. Well, we found evidence there that there were great limestone walls, like an aqueduct that brought water from the west to this site. This was an active site, there was temples here, and when we go to the other pyramid, you'll see docks where boats used to come. So this site was over 12,000 years old. Now the third pyramid that's down there is a so-called Black Pyramid. That is mostly mud brick collapsed. We know it is a Middle Kingdom construction, about 1800 BCE, associated with two kings. It's not sure who it was. One's Amenemhat II, another Senusert. But we know for sure that it's what we call a symbolic perka, a symbolic tomb. No one was ever buried in there, but there's no resonance, no sound. So there's no way this structure is built right after this structure, and it's the same type of technology. It's thousands and thousands of years of difference. This such structure is over 12,000 years. This is 1800 BCE. And it's collapsed, mostly mud brick with very little limestone. So there's water still going through this site. This was an active site bringing water in for energy to the pyramids. We see evidence of aqueducts. We'll show you docks and
Yusuf will show us around the corner where the water's still coming.
We're now at the Red Pyramid, which is next to the Bent Pyramid. And we're very fortunate because this one we get to go into. So what'll be intriguing for me is to see how big the passageway is to get into the Red Pyramid. How wide is it? How tall is it? And of course, this pyramid, like most, are believed by Egyptologists to have been tombs. The other more intriguing theory, which is far more complicated and I think far more plausible, is that these were power plants, electrical generators. So therefore, it'll be interesting to see, is this a passageway inside to where the tomb of the king is? Or is it a passageway, service entrance to the internal workings of a very, very ancient machine that predates history as we know it, as in older than 6,000 years ago, older than the pharaohs, older than the dynastic Egyptians.
Okay, we're up on the Red Pyramid, and Saqqara is in the background. Over to that side is Giza. The pyramids are lined up but not in a straight line. It's actually a Fibonacci spiral. And next, we're going to go inside the Red Pyramid.
Would you like to take a photo of me?
Oh, I'll be glad to. Yeah? So you want to
get Thank you.
At this point, I'm going to have to
Okay, this is at the bottom of the shaft, entrance into the Red Pyramid. Hundreds of feet that we came down at an angle. Again, you see, 3 feet by 3 feet is the basic dimension. Oh! Now we turn and enter the core of the Red Pyramid in Egypt. Torch, so this is how you can see almost the baffling that's on the in the interior of the Red Pyramid. Definitely for resonance or acoustics, wouldn't you say, Mark?
Absolutely.
So it's the sonic effect in here, reverberation, etc., which is amazing. If you hit the right tone, then the whole room vibrates. And again, that lends credence to the idea that this was not the tomb of a dead king, but that this had a very pragmatic function, and that was a vibrational function. So people are toning away in here because this thing has astonishing resonance properties. Again, adding credence to the idea that it was a pragmatic building when it was constructed and not a tomb. And the precision you can see here. This groove, you see, isn't really a good example of the precision of the fit of the work, because it's channeled in left and right like that. So you've got like this V shape going in. So that's not a good example. But as we come down to where the stone's been broken, here, look at that. I don't even know if you can see that, but that is a join between two stones, and it's so close together, you can't fit anything in there. I don't even know if water could seep into that. That is really, that's out of this world. Okay, we've just walked below ground, and
now this is the entrance to the Serapeum, which is where there are more than 20 boxes. Boxes are made of hard stone. Each one weighs more than 50 tons, and that's being very conservative. So as you can see, it's hewn. This area is hewn out of the bedrock. So you see the lid of this one, and you see the box itself. They were found inside of these niches just like this. So the main Egyptological theory is that they were the burial places of sacred Apis bulls. But they're more beyond the door. But what's intriguing is the interior of the box, because the precision is supposedly very 21st century, or at least 20th century. Look at the scale of this. So we weren't able to film that very well because of the distance. Only Chris and two others were allowed in. But actually, it's amazingly cool in here too. It's not like inside the pyramids, which are hot. But what Chris was able to show is that the flat surface of the interior of that massive box, combined weight of the box and the lid, at least 60, 70 tons, is that the flatness of the internal surface is within thousands of an inch of being perfectly flat, and also that the corners are 90 degrees, not 89, not 91, but he has a precision square that he uses in the manufacturing industry. That's what he used, and he found that the corners were exactly-ish.
So this is, the thing is, all of these boxes, there are at least 22 of them in here, again, combined weight, probably at least 60 tons combined weight, if not 80 or more tons. The lid by itself is more than 10 tons, but we see that. Sorry?
The box is 70 tons and the lid is 30 tons.
Okay, Stephen Mailer says the box itself is 70 tons, the lid is 30 tons. But what we're seeing is we're seeing them in different states of completion. Some of them are very rough. That one is quite glossy smooth. But the ultimate one is supposedly right down here at the end.
And we can go down and see close.
And we can go down and see close, which is what we want. Whoa. Oh, here we go.
Here you get the great example of what you want to show, that these markings couldn't possibly be original.
Oh.
Couldn't possibly be original.
No, those are very rough.
And here's the proof that Yusuf just showed. An empty cartouche, meaning this was not prepared for anybody. They left it open. Somebody could pay them enough money to have their title put in there.
Right.
So this is obviously not made for somebody. The markings put in much, much later.
Right.
And this is one where Chris goes inside and measures the tolerances to 2/10,000ths of an inch. You just feel the surface, flat, perfect, perfectly flat. In basalt.
Yeah.
And look at this perfect right angle cut, perfect all the way down, all four sides.
This is more like it. This is great.
This is the ultimate smoking gun. This cannot be explained by their conventional methods. And at least when they opened this tomb, this area, in December 2012, the head of archaeology of ancient Egypt said to CNN, to MSNBC, to Al Jazeera, we don't know how this was done. And that's honest. We appreciate that, his honesty, because Egyptology cannot explain this to any degree.
Well, the idea that it was made for bulls, no matter how special they were, is just ridiculous.
Bull. It's a lot of
it's bull. So this box in particular is amazing because I got to look inside. And the outside, or the inside, is as smooth as the outside. To the hand, it's flat, as in flat as a glass tabletop. And how could that have possibly been achieved when it is at least 6 feet tall, it is at least 10 feet long, and at least 6 feet wide, and at least 15 inches thick,
and the lid is solid and weighs much more than 10 tons. How could they have moved that block of stone from the quarry at Aswan? How could they have shaped it? How could they have brought it down into its niche? And again, there are at least 22 of them here. There are supposedly other chambers beyond in that direction, possibly vertically down as well. What was the function of these incredible stone boxes?
We're at a site called Abu Ruwash in Egypt. Never heard of it? Most people haven't, because it's not on the tourist map. But what it is are the remnants of an exploded pyramid. Exploded by what? Ancient cataclysm at the end of the last ice age. And this is an excellent example, as chronicled by Chris Dunn in his book, Ancient Technologies, of a machined surface. Yusuf Awiyan.
These are not markings of any kind of hammers and chisels.
No way.
You can see that it's been
No
eaten.
Way. Look at these lines. Look Same at these striations. Like
exactly.
Look at these striations.
And also the higher parts and the lower parts shows that it was not
exactly.
all cut at once.
Exactly.
It was like...
Especially
know,
here. This.
Here and here.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, here and there.
Exactly. You can see where the blade came back.
But the fact that it's arched...
Yes.
Curved. ...makes us wonder what kind of tool was used.
The illustrations?
Yeah, it's a beautiful, beautiful pattern. You see the striations running this way, and you see the definitive pattern.
I can see it, and I can't get it in my camera.
Oh,
going
yes,
this way.
We've got it.
Oh, here it is.
So it's an arc.
So you see this
it
is
arcs
curved.
Like that,
yeah.
curved.
The Chris Dunn's latest book.
And the cutter most likely moved in this direction.
Has to be machined. Cannot be done by hand.
Hopefully this is not the only example here, but this is an incredible example. And here especially, you see where the tool was cutting higher than here, which is also repeated here. There's a step down from this surface, or this level, to that level, and then down to that level. And it is a beautiful arc. So you're looking at the limestone interior of the Abu Ruwash pyramid, and this is the core, and we can descend into the core in this unique structure, unlike the other pyramids, and have a look at the base of it. So about two-thirds of the way down the ramp in Abu Ruwash, and you can see the limestone blocks here, and on this side. But what's more intriguing is the fact that this is all bedrock. So this massive channel, and presumably the pyramid that was above it, was carved straight into the bedrock, which is limestone. You see all the different layers that go down. And then in the core part, again, we see limestone built up and down into the interior.
So this is all limestone bedrock you're looking at that was cored out.
Yeah.
What we came down was the descending passage.
So what we see here is obviously not a pyramid that was open to the air, as some people would think. But this is the lower part of the pyramid construction, which had to be cut in the mound.
Right.
So this was like the repairing work before they constructed the pyramid. As what happened to most of the sites in Egypt, this pyramid was almost totally quarried, and All what we can see is the underground work, which is still impressive. To see this cut in the mound straight ahead like that, and then this big space that we are standing in now was going to be the location where they house the focal chambers of the pyramid on the underground. There could be other focal chambers in the core or in the middle, like the difference between the subterranean and the queen's and the king chamber, so-called, yeah, labeled like that. Abu Rawash is one of the sites that not much people visit because, you know, it's a very, very expensive permission. And they think there is not much hieroglyphs here to read or to see, not much decorations. But for people like us who search for the truth, we come here to look about how much work needs to be done even before you start putting your stones. And nobody mentions that. Nobody mentions that the underground work of every pyramid complex is as powerful and great as the pyramid construction itself. So imagine you're trying to do this cut into that mound with copper chisels and wooden hub. And we can see, of course, that the erosion for thousands of years, but if you look up there at these pieces, you can see how straight this surface used to be.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And how can this be accomplished by any primitive tools? The combination of stones we see here is not so much different from any other pyramid complex. We get quartzite, rose granite, basalt, and at least three different types of limestone. One of them can be local to the area, and the two others had to be brought from two different quarries.
Mm-hmm.
So, and of course, diorite. There is lots of leftovers from diorite here after quarrying, of course, which shows that this pyramid was somehow close to the construction of the third pyramid complex, which was also cased almost all of it with granite, and the box inside is made from diorite, and we find lots of pieces from diorite around the complex of the third pyramid as well, Menkaure.
What are you looking at?
But for the record, Yusuf's father, Hakim, believed it was evidence of a cataclysm, that his pyramid was originally blown out or weakened severely, which would make it easier for later cultures to quarry.
And so, what time frame would that be?
It would be 10, 12,000 years ago.
So Yusuf Awiyan just pointed this out. Look at that difference. See the right side where the stone is broken, the left side where clearly it's been cut. And if you look carefully, the spacing in between each one of those striations is, at a guess, 2 to 3 millimeters. So that means every pass of the tool had to move into the stone by 2 to 3 millimeters. The stone is basalt, and you notice that there's a curve to the cut. So this could very well have been a circular saw. And if it was, it would have to have been somewhere in the order of minimum, one would guess, 5 meters across. So nobody in modern times is going to come here with a 5 meter diameter diamond saw and cut this stone. This looks like it's evidence of lost ancient high technology.
So here we have black granite and more of these core drill holes. And you can see that clearly, you can see the striations hopefully. There. And again, a ballpark guess is 2 to 3 millimeters per revolution. And here are my fingers to show you that these are not little things. These are big core drills going in at least as far as my hand goes in. And in this case, we can't really see, but in other examples, you can see that it's a drill which is hollow. It's only maybe an eighth of an inch in diameter, or in the wall is about an eighth of an inch boring through. And so I would guess, if we have any people watching this video that work with